Hello, everybody listening tonight. My guest this week on Mark's Mouthpiece is one of my favorite trumpet players, David Bilger, principal trumpet of the Philadelphia Orchestra. And before we get started, I'd like to thank my two sponsors for tonight, Euclid IQ, which is the world's leader in video and audio compression. And this week, I'd like to thank Guard Bags for the sponsorship. And so if you have a guard bag, you can put plenty of things in it, like Fritz Domro's new book, Shape Up. And a plug for Studio 259 Productions for our Vincent Chickowitz book. So,
buy them both.
Buy them both. Do you know the Shape Up book? Have you seen this?
I don't, and I should, because I spent a week in Hamamatsu with Fritz, and we hung out, did a lot of teaching together, played some together, and ate some sushi and other things. Win and whatever else, and a little sake, and tossed back a few beers, and he's what a great guy, and a phenomenal player, and a really focused pedagogue. So I'd like to see the book. When did it come out?
I think it's self-published. I think you maybe put it out last year, and there are some YouTube videos of him demonstrating stuff on it. It's all in German, but he has as everybody's doing it. Yeah, we can figure that out. But yeah, hopefully,
you get it's okay for Fritz. He speaks like 12 languages or something.
That's right. It's really good. It's very, very, very stamp based book. So it's
terrific. Yeah, I got to check it out.
And so I kind of wanted to kind of go through some of your background for some people that don't know as much. How old were you when you started to play?
I was in fourth grade, so that'd be 10 years old.
10 years old.
And I've been playing for 100 years. It's good.
So talk a little bit about the beginning. Was there, what made you pick the trumpet?
Wow. We had like grade school band, and they paraded all the fourth graders through a room, and they had all the instruments, and you could pick whether you wanted to participate. Then you got to pick your instrument. And I really wanted to play the trombone because my dad had played the trombone and my brother played the trombone. And they were like, we don't want to. I think my mom said, no more trombones in the family. You know, it's a little too much. So I just liked the look of it was a cornet. And the case had this really cool crushed velour color, like bluish purple. I thought it looked cool. So that was the whole reason. It wasn't much more than that. It wasn't like drawn to the sound of the trumpet or some sort of, you know, mystical, mythical thing. It was just like, oh yeah, everybody plays in band and that looks cool. I'll try that.
Wow. I wanted to play the saxophone and my grandmother talked me out of it. And she said,
that was smart. She was a smart woman. Smart
woman. So thank you for that. So was there a lot of music in your house that you said your father played trombone and your brother?
Yeah, my mom's father, my grandfather, was a violinist, and not by trade. He was a dentist, but he had put himself through dental school teaching and playing the violin, and he loved music, and my parents had a love of music as well. So I started on the piano when I was in second grade, and then so that was my original background was piano. And I kept playing up through 2 years of lessons in college, so I could actually get around it pretty well, but not well enough that I could ever make a living playing it. I mean, I had like a good right hand and my left hand was like, forget about it. So, right. You know, I also play jazz on the piano and, you know, again, not good enough to make money doing it, but, to enjoy it. So, that was sort of the end. And we listened to music. There was always stuff going on. There was always music going on. My brother was actually a really phenomenal trombone player. He played a concerto with the Milwaukee Symphony. He won their youth competition and you know, was like this super duper, you know, talent on the instrument, perfect pitch and all this stuff. And unfortunately, he also has an IQ of 160. So he ended up being an electrical engineer and making his career that. But he still, you know, pre-pandemic, he was still gigging like 3-4 nights a week on the trombone. He still loves it. So.
Wow. So yeah. With that kind of a brother playing trombone and you start on the cornet, what kind of music was being played in the house?
Well, there was, you know, it was everything from symphonic stuff. My dad liked things like Gilbert and Sullivan, which, you know, when you listen to it now, it feels a little funny and dated, but that's the whole point of it, I think, is that it's light opera, it's comic. And then when I was in junior high school, there was a teacher named Mr. Russo. I remember this dude because he had hair like halfway down his back and he wore leather school. And this was in the suburbs in Milwaukee. It was like almost rural. And he was this hipster. And he would bring me 5 jazz albums a week from his collection to listen to. And then I'd bring him back the next Monday, and he'd have 5 more waiting for me. So there was a lot of music going on there. And then it turned out he sang in the Milwaukee Symphony Opera Chorus. So he looked like a hipster, but he had a classical training, and he loved jazz, and he turned me onto that, like, in a major way. And then, of course, I was always listening to Chicago Symphony recordings and you know, Maurice André recordings for solo stuff. I mean, you know. It was sort of the era. There weren't the choices, you know, the same sort of choices we have now in terms of how much stuff is recorded. Now there's just, you know, it's anything you want, 25 versions of it all on Spotify. But back then you actually had to, you know, buy an LP and store this big vinyl thing in your house. You know, it was like, oh my goodness. It was varied. It was really varied. Yeah.
Do you still listen to vinyl now?
No, but I still have them all. I've got cases and cases of vinyl. I should probably digitize them, but you know.
But the absorption of music was different then, because you had a week to kind of absorb these records and then turn them back around.
And sometimes I begged to keep them an extra week, and they always let me.
Yeah.
But there were some Freddie Hubbard records. I was like, no, I got to keep listening to that. And he turned me on to Lee Morgan, who was, you know, I still listen to. I think Lee Morgan was an absolute genius, and you know. I would have found Miles on my own, right? Because everybody owns Kind of Blue, but and Bitches Brew and all the pre stuff. I mean, the early stuff with the group with Coltrane in it is just nuts. Like Relaxin' and those records, those
Prestige records,
Prestige re-releases. Those are just ridiculous to listen to. I've got those on my iPhone. They're every time I'm on a plane, I'm listening to that.
Wow.
But I have all those on vinyl too, somewhere. I know where they are. They're in a box like 20 feet away from me. But I don't even own a record player right now. I should get one.
No, it's a little bit of fun that way. It can get really expensive. But so talk about as your playing developed. So you started taking lessons fairly early, I would assume. Also,
yeah. No, I was the luckiest guy on the planet because the guy who started me in public school, fourth grade, happened to be a trumpet player. So he set me up really well. I mean, if I'd had a sax player as a band director then, who knows? I might be selling, you know, insurance or something. But he, as a trumpet player, really knew how to set me up, and it was great. And what's funny is he just reached out to me over the web. Like, I was surprised he was sort of still around, because I think he's pushing 90 at this point, or in his 80s anyway. And he was still like running a big band up till the pandemic, you know, and he's still out there doing stuff. And I, you know, I got to thank him for setting me up so well. And then I started taking lessons in junior high with a guy named Robert Dominiak, who was a commercial player. He was also band director by day. And then he played all the shows that came through town. Really, really fine player. And those lessons were sit there. It was one book. It was Arban.
Yeah.
And we would, you know, and then at the end of the lesson, he'd get out his trumpet and we'd play a duet, an Amsden or a Gotti or something, you know, one of those easy old books.
Yeah.
And that was the lesson. You know, it was just busting through every little section of Arban, you know, for years. And then I think around end of ninth grade, early 10th grade, he said, you know, you need another teacher. I think we'd gotten through the Arban book. Right. Yeah. And then I started taking lessons with Dennis Najum, and that was also life-changing. He's amazing. And we're still in touch actually. And he has a new book out. You should get him on the show.
I should. And I probably will.
Definitely will. So that was like this exposure to more of the orchestral stuff. We'd learn an excerpt and he'd get out his vinyl and play like, okay, well, we're going to work on the opening of Mahler 5, and he'd have 4 different recordings. And we'd listen to him, talk about what was different, what we liked, what we didn't, what conductors might expect, and then blow through it. And it was just, you know, it was brilliant teaching. I mean, the guy's awesome. And technical stuff too. I mean, I remember first lesson, he was like, okay, your rhythm's not good. We're going to go back to, you know, these Max Patag preparatory melodies for the French horn, right? Which are just like, it's like starting back with Getchell. And and fortunately, I was raised in a family where you listened to the teacher and you did exactly what you were told. So I didn't have any issue going back and playing quarter notes and trying to play dotted eighth sixteenths, like real dotted eighth sixteenths, you know, because he was nailing me on stuff like that. And it was another, also just this great basis. And, and you know, a few years of amazing lessons.
Do you have any memory of like how your band director set you up? Like, what was the, was there anything in particular that you remember?
Not really. It was like, you know, say M, put the mouthpiece, you know, like,
Basically,
put it on the bottom lip and then bring the mouthpiece up and just blow. And you know, but he made sure things were centered. He made sure that there wasn't more going on than needed to be, you know?
Right.
think it was, you know, probably nothing super special, but just really aware of making sure that the basic stuff was all in the right place and that the bad habits didn't start at age 10.
Right.
I'm sure they came in later. All that stuff you have to unlearn in college.
I don't think so. Well, and then so you had an amazing upbringing basically on the trumpet between all those teachers and going through.
Yeah, I had great teachers and amazing public school music programs. My high school, the high school band director, John Hibbler, was amazing. We played, you know, whole suites and, you know, just the band program was like the wind ensemble was awesome. Really great stuff. Hindemith Symphony and B flat stuff that you know, some people don't even get through in college these days anymore.
Right.
Too busy playing Mislanka Symphony No. 4 and Circus Maximus and all this really hard stuff. But that connection to like, what's the history of the genre? And then you can expand from there. And that kind of basis is something that I'm incredibly appreciative for. And it came from these, you know, mostly public school music teachers who were incredibly committed to what they were doing and loved it and loved the students and loved to teach. And they worked with kids who were patient and willing to learn the lessons.
Wow.
And you know, it was awesome. I couldn't have had a better, you know, better upbringing.
Did, in living at, right around Milwaukee, did you go hear the Milwaukee Symphony when Dennis was playing in the orchestra?
Oh, sure, yeah. I had two, there were two opportunities. MSO played, and I remember going, when I was pretty young, to a school concert and hearing Firebird and just be like, oh my gosh, that's what an orchestra can do? And it wasn't one of these programs that maybe some orchestras do now where it's like, we'll talk and we'll bring out a puppeteer and we'll do, you know, the stuff that they feel like maybe you have to do and maybe you do now. I don't know. But back then it was like, we trust you to be able to sit in a chair and listen to really great stuff. And so those youth concerts were, it was real rep.
Yeah.
And there's something so powerful about hearing a good orchestra play real rep.
Yeah.
It was, you know, again, life-changing. And then at that point in that era, 10 times a year, Chicago Symphony came to Milwaukee. Now, half the programs listed Schulte as a conductor, and he never came. It was always, Maestro Schulte is sick tonight. We have a guest. You know, and it was all assistant conductor, whoever was on cover that week, you know, coming up, because he didn't want to schlep up to Milwaukee to play.
Right.
But those were Monday nights, and the youth orchestra rehearsed Monday nights. So we would finish youth orchestra and finish up right around 8:30 with youth orchestra. And then I'd sneak in a lighting booth and get to hear CSO for the second half of the concerts.
Wow.
So I got to hear Herseth play Pictures and Mahler 5 and like all of this stuff live in the room, you know, in a free seat.
Even better.
Breaking the rules. But but just to, you know, see how beat red he was turning sometimes and hear that sound in a hall when you're trying to figure out what sound is, you know, wow.
Wow.
You know, so between hearing Milwaukee and then hearing Chicago, you know, at least several times a year, it was up close and live like that. It's,
wow.
It's, you know, makes an impression for sure.
So we'll get into your studies at Illinois in a minute, but as you're exiting high school, what kind of rep were you playing at that point?
I was playing hard stuff. My first solo gig was in junior high playing the Haydn with the band on B flat trumpet.
Haydn with in high school?
Junior high school.
In junior high school.
Yeah. Wow. That was my first, it was just the first two movements. But so, you know, I had a head start on some of that kind of stuff. So I was the rep that I was taking around for college auditions was you know, obviously the usual excerpts that everybody asked for and the etudes that everybody, well, it was different, but they weren't asking Charlie etudes at the time. It was more things like Bousquet and even the Verm book, 40 Studies, which is a great book. Overlooked, great high school book. And then the solo pieces that I was taking out, I was playing Lovelock, mm-hmm. which is, it was like pretty crazy. I'm not sure why I was playing that, but it was like, hey, I like this. Can I learn this? And Dennis is like, yeah, sure. Don't tell him it's hard. Right. So I had that and I forget what else, but it was major. It was big. It was big rep. Probably stuff, you know, well, on Haydn, I was taking out, you know, for college auditions as well. So I think that was what I was doing in high school at that point.
I mean, this is skipping ahead a little bit. Have you played the Lovelock very often? Is it?
Oh no, I don't do it anymore. I think it's a good piece. Is it a great piece? I mean, that's one of those things. It's hard to get orchestras to hire a trumpet soloist as it is. Right. Usually the way the discussion goes is, okay, do you want to play Haydn or Hummel? And it's like, well, no, can I do this? Well, do you want to do Hummel and E, or do you want to do Haydn? It's like, how about this? Well, maybe as a stretch, we can do Artunian. It's like, well, how about, you know, that's how it usually goes.
Right, right.
So getting to do something like Lovelock where they don't know the composer at all, it's tough. I was really pushing Philly to let me do some other stuff. And I've had some good fortune with that. I did Christian Lindbergh, Achtung Bunker, 3 years ago, actually 3 years ago this week. Wow. Which is a very, very cool piece. I mean, it's really, really good. But I had wanted to do the Zimmermann, Nobody Knows the Trouble I See, because I figured, you know, how many more years am I going to be able to play that kind of piece? But you look at it and it's like, oh, it's got a string orchestra and a jazz orchestra, and there's Hammond organ and electric guitar. How many subs and saxophones? How many subs are we hiring? And, oh, come on, we don't have rehearsal time for that. Do you want to do Haydn or Hummel? Right. And so that's when I got him to do the Lindbergh, because it's for chamber orchestra. And even though the third movement is Turkish jazz, it's still very approachable orchestrationally, and we could get away with doing it on you know, part of one rehearsal and a dress. Because that's the reality of American orchestras.
Well, I can only imagine the looks of some of the college teachers when you pulled out Lovelock. Coming in as a freshman, they must have been a little bit.
Wow. Well, Dave Hickman, I think, was like, "Oh, okay, yeah, I'll hear a little of that." He didn't tip his hand at all. It was like, "Yeah, okay. Yeah. What else do you have? Yeah. Oh, okay. Opening a Mahler. Yeah, it's okay. Yeah, I'd like to hear that. Yeah. It was funny."
So you were already really well set up by the time you went to school at Illinois to study with him.
Yeah, and part of it was I did this show troupe in the summers called the Kids from Wisconsin, which was sort of like Up with People. I don't know if you know that.
Yeah, I remember that.
Like we're all, you know, wholesome kids, and you know, we had to like smile and get short haircuts. This is my COVID cut. I did 4 summers with that band, and it was, I think, a total of 212 concerts over 4 summers.
Oh.
So we were doing over 50 shows a year in the summers. And a lot of the show was memorized. And it was a song and dance troupe, but the band was really good.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we'd go out front and do features and stuff. And some of the people who were in that band, one of them that was in that band is a guy named Dan Fornero. I don't know if you know.
Yeah,
Dan.
Absolutely.
He played in that same group.
Wow.
And, Oh, a guy who was principal in Toluca, a big guy.
Yes.
Oh man, I just.
I'm seeing.
We just did a thing, web thing together, like a couple of weeks ago. But he played it, and you look at the players that came out of it. There's another guy who's a really talented musician named Bruce Wormuth, and he came out of that band. It was all these people funneling through, through that thing, because you played hours and hours and hours and hours and hours a day, and there were jazz tunes, and I played. Mendez La Virgen de la Macarena out in front of the band, like, you know, in front of 10,000 people at a Coliseum, you know, you walk out front, you do it. And it's just what you end up doing. And so I had like a lot of face, I think, from playing that. And what was playing lead in it for the last 3 years I was in the band. And so it was like, I had a small commercial setup and I had this great old Benj trumpet and, you know, just with a little bit of flame throwing going on there. But it was, I think, really great for my playing to have that sort of directness in the production. Wow. So between the legit stuff and then like, you know, putting that over into more of a commercial setting, I think it was really helpful.
It gave you a lot of face, no doubt. I mean,
it was good, and it also exposed me to styles, and I'd gotten a scholarship to go to undergrad school from Woody Herman. He had a scholarship fund where you had, you know, a lot of people would apply, and you'd go into a recording studio and you recorded a tune with rhythm section, and then they listened to them back, and I got a scholarship out of that, and it really helped me go to school. So,
wow.
You know, it's, you never know. I mean, right? Did you think Woody Herman knew I'd be in the Philadelphia Orchestra? Gosh, no.
But Woody Herman,
oh, this kid can get around the horn. Okay, I guess, you know, we'll give him $1,000, which back then was like, you know. It was like half the tuition for a term. I mean, it was a good deal. It was, you know.
But Woody Herman was listening to your audition music himself.
Well, he wasn't in the room. They recorded it, and
he was on the tour bus.
Right.
Right. Wow. That's.
Yeah, and then there was an award ceremony, and I got to like go out on the stage. I didn't get. They didn't let us play. There were a couple of other people who got awards as well, but, you know, we got to hear them play and be. On a concert that they gave in Milwaukee. So
amazing. Was,
you know,
oh, I think you're thinking about
lots of opportunity, and I feel really blessed and really fortunate to have had that all of those different experiences growing up. But it's also, you know, I had interests for it. I had the desire to learn, and, you know, I try to keep doing that, you know.
Was it John Ernest, by the way, that was there?
Yes. No, it wasn't John. It was John Ernest. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Wow, you got it going on, man. Or did you web? Did you look that up?
Somebody may or may not have just texted that to me.
Gotcha. Yeah, it's John. I can't believe I just spaced his name, because we were literally on a web thing like 3 weeks ago together. I hope he's not watching. But some really great people came out of that little song and dance troupe, you know.
That's but 50 concerts in a summer. That's a lot.
That's a lot. It's a lot. Yeah.
And you must have also learned about recovery and how to take care of yourself to get ready for a show versus.
Well, we were also self-contained. So we set up the sound. We ran mic cables. We ran a mixing board. We all knew how to do, like, we all had jobs like that. And so we figured out how to, you know, it was like, There were 30 of us, including, or 32, including the singers, dancers. But the band did a lot of that, you know, the grunt stuff, because the other folks were the, you know, they were the stars. We were just the band. But, you know, learning how to work a mic and doing some emceeing. I mean, literally, I had to get up in front of audiences and talk.
Wow.
Like, that was not something I was good at. And I learned. I had to learn, right?
Oh, it's an invaluable skill, especially now. Right. So,
well, yeah, I mean, I didn't know at the time, but it was a little nerve-wracking. It was harder than playing at the time, and now it's like, yeah, I'm fine with a mic, you know.
Yeah.
It's cuz of Zoom. But you know, those are those experiences where you take a risk. You know, it's like I had to give up my whole summer. We started like the day after school let out, and you know, it went through Labor Day every year. It was like a long season, and it was a lot of schlepping and buses and living, you know, four guys to a Holiday Inn hotel room. I was like, oh gosh, you know.
Wow.
We got paid, but it wasn't much.
I do remember the Up With People thing when they came through. I remember they came through my high school and they're all singing and dancing and clean haircuts and the everything's happy. Yeah. And yeah, catchy theme song.
Yeah, yeah. This was called The Kids from Wisconsin. So we were a lot more regional than that.
Okay.
But but it still exists. You know, I did a web thing with them recently, and it was just, they're still out there and they're still training kids up on how to do this. A lot of people have ended up in musical theater.
Wow.
In fact, one of the dancers from when I was in there was just on the Grammys. She was still dancing. She's like 60 years old and she was dancing the Grammys.
Wow. I thought you were going to say Solid Gold.
It was with some rap guy I'd never heard of, but she was in a cloak or something. It was weird, but still doing it, you know, and was in like a movie, you know, so you meet some interesting people, but it's really expanding instead of getting boxed into doing one thing.
Right. Right.
And it really served me well, especially when I was in New York as freelancing and then when I got to Dallas, cause there was a lot of pops there and I was set up in a good way to play a lot of the pop stuff. Well, do a lot less of that now.
That's true. Well, when you were with Hickman, so you were set up obviously very well. So what kind of stuff was Dave working on you, working with you?
He was a brilliant teacher. And we started off with Longinati 12 studies, which is still one of my favorite books too. Mm-hmm. And it was like, take it through this. Here's how you do. A lot of it was here's how it goes, kid. And he would play it and you'd play it back and try to match. It was a lot of like, you know, listen, play, listen, do, very organic, not quite so much of like, you're going to manipulate this and think about, you know, not really overtly technical. Not that he doesn't know all that stuff, because he does, but it just really holistic sort of approach. And he also has that ability to sit there for an hour in a lesson and then pick up a trumpet and like sound great. I still don't know how he does that, right? I mean, it was really special. But we did a lesson every week and then a group lesson. So the lesson we were working on etudes, you know, we got through some Charlier and and then solos and excerpts and stuff, and then a group lesson with two other guys where we would play orchestral excerpts as a section.
Wow.
Which some weeks was awesome, and some weeks we would joke we're group lesen, German for reading. We were sight reading. Like when I think about like, oh, that should have prepped that. But what are you going to do? Are you going to learn your etude, or are you going to like really dig into Sibelius II when you know how to transpose and you can sort of, it doesn't look like much on the page? Well, should have listened and should have prepped.
Right.
Some weeks I did, a couple weeks every now and then probably didn't.
Yeah.
And I still carry that guilt inside.
No, you don't.
No, a little bit. You know, it's missed opportunities, because he was great at just taking people through stuff and getting like such a solid understanding. But I was always prepped for the lessons. So.
Yeah. Well, you know, I've always, the last time I saw you in person, we were talking about some things I'd read that you had written. They were kind of good organizational things about things you should practice and organizing a recital. Was that stuff you picked up from Hickman when you were in school?
Oh yeah, he was great. I mean, he was making a living as a soloist. So what did he do? He played recital tours and solos with orchestras. And it was maybe 2 weeks ago, somebody posted on Facebook his Tamburg concerto with the Champaign-Urbana Symphony from like 1978.
He must have killed him.
And it was like, whoa. It was magical. There was so much fire. So that's what he did. And then he would go on these recital tours, some with piano, some with organ.
Yeah.
He had a duo with William Neal, who was organist of the National Symphony. And so there was a lot of, well, here's how you set up recitals. And I started doing recitals really young. I think I did 6 or 7 solo recitals as an undergrad.
Wow.
Started doing them early. First couple were split with somebody, and then I started doing my own, just because, you know, you work up rep. Why shouldn't you play it in public, right?
Right, right. Well, I was going to ask you a little later, but I'll ask now that we're on the topic of recitals. Can you talk about how you decide to program repertoire for a recital? Because sometimes I feel like with a trumpet recital, there's the recitals where you love to listen to it because it's great music, and then you go to a recital where it's like somebody's hitting you over the head, like, I'm going to hit play every hard thing, and it's going to be, and I'm a trumpet player,
Well, you know,
take that.
yeah, but you know, it's different depending on what the audience you're playing for, where it is. Student recitals are different than professional recitals. And I'll say right now that it's a different world now. I think when I think back to some of the programs I did, it wasn't necessarily all the hardest stuff. In fact, sometimes not, you know, like specifically like doing some song transcriptions that aren't technical but really give you a chance to sing.
Right.
Those can be really great foils to playing, you know, all the fast, hard stuff. But now, you know, a lot of places are looking for lighter stuff, things that are more appealing to audiences. And so you really have to take the audience into consideration when you're programming. So there isn't one formula. But what I like to do is start with the entrees, you know, one entree per half, one sort of major piece per half, and then program around those. And these days I'm much more into the idea of not playing concertos with piano reduction. Although, you know, college solo recitals, everybody should play a Haydn and a Hummel. So there goes that, right? And everybody should play a piccolo piece. And I don't like doing them with piano, but again, you should be doing that because you need to play that repertoire in public. So, you know, it sort of depends. But back to your question, you know, okay, here's the meat and potatoes. And then, like, what am I going to use to open? Timing wise, do I need like a piece between the opener if it's something really short? Like, I loved opening with the Turin Caprice because it's 4 minutes, it's flashy, it's tuneful, it's fun to play, puts you in a good place. But usually that would make for too short a half. So then you need something to bridge those, whatever's the third piece, you know, the meat and potatoes. And then open the second half with something substantial and then work your way into dessert at the end. So it's, you know.
Well, for people who haven't seen, there's some great videos of you playing the pennington on
Oh,
YouTube.
that was fun. That was, oh, jeez, I'm wearing the same jacket. I do own more clothes, but it's pandemic. This was in the front of the closet tonight. So,
We didn't plan this either, by the way. This was all impromptu. Our black and blue.
Black shirts. It's black shirt night. Yeah, that was really fun. That was for the ICTIS competition, which I think it was a brilliant idea and way before its time because it was all virtual and now we're all virtual all the time, right? But Alex Serio, who runs that, was like, "Hey, can I get you to play something so we can put out a video?" And it's like, "Well, sure. Like what?" He goes, "Well, I want something, you know, 6, 7 minutes long." And I'm thinking, "All right, Inesco Legend. Do we need another one of those recorded?" And I love all of that music from, you know, between 1920 and the 1900 and the early 20s from France at Paris Conservatory stuff that people don't play as much. I mean, there's a lot of really cool pieces like Gaubert. There's Paris pieces. There's a whole bunch.
That whole rap recording Reinhold Friedrich did of all
Yeah,
those.
La Belle Epoque. It's a great disc. I mean, it's just a beautiful disc. You know, I'm a Reinhold fanboy. I love his playing. I mean, there's such a point of view to every note. You know, it's just there's never an autopilot going on there. He just
There's
that wild personality that you can tell by looking at his hair that comes out the bell, and I just love that. But Pannequin is a piece that I, you know, I hadn't actually played on a recital before. It was like, oh, well, not a very hard piece, really, right? I mean, it fits the fingers well, and we were doing it like in a 1 hour session. You know, we just, you know, rehearsed a little and ran it a couple times, and they said, "Yeah, okay, it looks good." I was like, "Yeah, okay, cool. There we go." And it was Alex's wife, Anna, who played the piano. She is stellar. I mean, it's like, oh, Alex, okay, your wife's going to play piano? Okay, I guess. I didn't know. And then I heard those first chords and I heard her warming up, or I'm warming up, and it's like, oh my gosh, she can seriously play. She's amazing. And then it's some friends of hers that were the videographers, and they're now doing the video for a Philadelphia Orchestra company called Rec Great. Today. They're beautiful, beautiful cinematographers, and also good musicians. The woman that is part of the couple that own that company is an amazing, amazing mandolin player. Who knew, right? She's just another one of these people, like, you just don't know until you hear it, you know? Right. Quiet and unassuming and doing something else, and then you hear them play, and it's like, well, that's just electric, you know? So that was incredibly fun to do. And when it got put out, it had something like 90,000 views, which is pretty good for trumpet music, I guess.
Well, it's great playing. I mean, have you ever thought about putting out a solo recording yourself, like top to bottom?
Yeah, who really wants that, you know?
I think you should do it.
I don't know. I have one of a new music that's all electroacoustic. I don't know if you know this.
I do know this recording.
Yeah, it's from the Dark Earth, it's called, and did it a lot of years ago with a composer named Meg Bowles. And her husband is Richard Price, who did all of those brass quintet Christmas arrangements that are just amazing.
Right.
And he did the engineering on he's now an audio engineer, amazing ears. Give a plug, Candlewood Digital, if you live in Connecticut, he's the best. But she had done a whole bunch of New Age discs, and I commissioned her actually to write a piece for an ITG conference for a recital I was doing, because I wanted something new. And she wrote a piece, and then I was doing a recital at National Cathedral, and I was like, hey, that would 5-second reverb, can you write me some more stuff? Because that sort of electroacoustic stuff in that space was, I thought, could be really cool. And so she wrote a suite of three pieces, and I was like, okay, now we got 25 minutes. You want to finish the disc? And so we worked together over the next months to get that done. And I think it's good. I think it's good stuff. It's different than a lot of,
right?
It's something different. I just look at the rep and I go, well, there's really good recordings of most stuff already out there, right? I mean, Reinhold already did all that stuff I love, right?
Did all that stuff. But, you know, one more take on it's not going to hurt. If you had 90,000 views on just the Pennington, maybe.
Right, but my student James Vaughn at Curtis, he did a thing where he was playing chopsticks, and he played the piano. Flight of the Bumblebee, and he did it, like, played the trumpet right-handed and played the piano with the left hand, and it had 200,000 views, like, in 5 minutes. Of course, you know, who can do that?
I know, people saw that, and then instantly 50,000 trumpet players sold their instruments probably right after
that.
Well,
every time I listen to him play, I go, how do you do that, dude?
He is phenomenal, and he's a great player.
When people ask me, what's the secret to teaching? It's like, have really good students. He's a case in point.
Yeah. So when you were at Illinois, you were taking you were starting to take auditions though, right?
I took one. Hickman sent me out to take one my freshman year, which was Phoenix Symphony. And I flew out there, and I remember that the flight was like ridiculously expensive to get from Champaign, Illinois. It was like on this little plane to St. Louis, and then it was like four connections or something to get. That was crazy. And actually made the finals, and then it was a no hire because I wasn't ready. And you know, clearly the screen came down and they saw some 18-year-old kid, and it was like, ain't no way. And they were right. I mean, I wasn't ready, but it was a great experience going through several rounds and seeing how that felt.
Wow. Yeah. And then you knew what to work on when you went back to school, I'm sure.
Well, yeah. I mean, it was like, well, okay. I got some work to do.
Yeah. Yeah. But then, now, was there a period in between Illinois, or you went right to Juilliard after that?
No, I went straight to Juilliard, yeah.
So, you know, the question is, what was it like with Gould, your first lesson? You remember your first lesson with Mark Gould?
Well, so I had been at National Repertory Orchestra. It was called Colorado Philharmonic back in the day. And I was rooming with this dude named Michael Sachs. I don't know where he is now, but
I don't know. Yeah.
Somewhere. I don't know. I don't know if he, is he still playing? And our third roommate was Doug Prosser. I don't know what he does either, but
did he make it?
but there were all these folks in that orchestra. I was out there 2 summers, and the first orchestra, I noticed that, like, first summer, that, like, I don't know, 15 people in the orchestra went to this school, Juilliard. I was like, yeah, maybe I should look at that for grad school. So I had auditioned at one place for a master's, which was maybe the stupidest thing ever, but I had really no idea that it was so hard to get in. And I don't know why Hickman let me just audition one place. I don't know. But I went and took a lesson with Gould.
Right.
And he answered the door. This was the first lesson before I was a student. He answered the door, and he's like wearing Birkenstocks and shorts and a polo shirt with food on it. His hair's disheveled, right? And you know, I go. He said, oh, come on in, come on in. Set up in here, and there was his music stand. And instead of music on the stand, it was New Yorker magazine. So he'd clearly been warming up while reading, you know.
Right.
And then it was really clear that he had ears that I had never experienced before. And it was clear, it was like, oh man, I really want to get in to study with him because his point of view. So at that first lesson, he goes, well, you play pretty good for some white boy from the Midwest, but you're in New York now and you got to learn how to play like a Jew. And I'm like, I had no idea what that meant, right?
Right.
I was this goyim from the Midwest. What do I know about, like, what do you mean play like a Jew? And what he meant was, you know, the heart and the heart on the sleeve and that emotionalism just oozing out. Sort of, if you've ever been to Israel, you know, there's a directness that's so beautiful. People, you know what people think, you know what's on their mind because it comes straight out. And that's what he meant. It took me a while. It took me a few lessons before I learned to decode and to be able to translate Mark Gould into Dave English. But that's basically what we did. You know, he was like, all right, your technique's in a good place. You know how to get around the horn. You're all good. But, you know. But I had been on the road my senior year with a group called the Eastern Brass Quintet, which was with, at the time, with Columbia Artist Management. It was with Cami. So I was sort of, my senior year in the undergrad was a bridge year between being in school and not being in school. So I found a way to sort of be on the road part-time and finish up a degree, and I ended up having to pull out of band for 1 semester, which was sad because Harry Beejian was the band director and he was like a second father. But he was happy for me to have the experience of sort of getting a head start on a career.
Wow. And
So
then
I had stuff, you know, I was sort of semi-pro at that point, going into Juilliard, but I needed that input from Mark. It really, you know, he woke me up. He was like, why are you doing that? Well, because that's how I was told to do it. Well, it's not wrong, but why are you doing it? Right? Because Hickman's holistic way was, here's how it go, copy this. Well, you learn from doing that. You follow that example. But this is like, well, but why? What? Why are you phrasing to here? How can you make that more compelling? How can you make that come to life more? Oh, what's the orchestration? Where's the harmony going? Oh, who am I playing with there? Oh, yeah, I want to do that because, or, oh, I better back off there because I'm equal to another instrument, like in an excerpt. Like, oh, I'm with the strings. It's not dominant. It's really even. All right, I need to color it in a different way. Stuff like that, and just opening ears, and then hearing him play at the Met. I mean, that was sort of it was state of the art, dude. I mean, I don't know if you ever heard him live,
Yeah, definitely heard him.
but those Wagner's operas. I mean, just listening to him, it was just really.
And then
You
there's
know,
the
he was putting out there what he was preaching. There was no, you know, that wasn't like all talk. It was like you heard it so clearly coming out the bell, and that just sort of knocks you over the head.
Aren't you in the video of playing off stage as on Lohengrin? Am I right about that?
Yes.
Yeah, it sounds great. I mean, it's for
Yeah,
people.
I actually listened to it again. Now you can't listen to it because of the conductor, but up until up until like 2017 when all that came out, you know, it's a great production, and listening to Mark in that, it's
In the
like,
Pit is phenomenal.
oh my gosh, you know,
He's
and it was like that, you know, we did 20 of those, and it was like that every night, you know,
Yeah.
just, and different every night, like, you know, because Levine was reacting to the singers. Can I say Levine?
You can.
Okay. He was reacting to the singers, and Mark was reacting to him, and there was just everything like moved, and it was not like performances where you just want to recreate from night to night. It was creative music making, and that's where Mark really excelled, was that, you know, the ears were always on.
Yeah.
And he had the goods to like bring it out, the bell and chain, and the confidence to change from night to night.
Right.
And I think that's one of the things that opera people do more than symphony players. Sometimes we, hopefully not me, but sometimes maybe I fall into it as well, where you get into this, well, it goes this way, and it's just like recreating something. And if that's what you're doing, just buy the CD, you know. It's like it should be more of a living craft, a living art. And the thing is, when you take risks, sometimes you miss.
And it's awfully exciting.
I'm okay with the miss. Some folks aren't. And sometimes, you know, people come to a concert and they'll be like, yeah, I heard him, he missed. Ooh. It's like, I heard Herseth miss. Did it matter? Oh my gosh, no, it didn't matter.
No.
I heard Maurice André do a concert. He missed a couple of notes. Still the most amazing thing I'd ever heard, you know? And so the note counting kind of gets in the way a little bit. And unfortunately, that's a, you know, late 20th, 21st century thing where we're so concerned with, oh, it's got to be perfect. It's going to be perfect. It's got to be this, and it's going to line up. And it's only gotten worse during the pandemic with layered videos where, oh, it's got to line up perfectly. I've got to do this. It's going to be like, it ends up sounding like a MIDI file.
Right.
Not that there's anything wrong with MIDI. MIDI's
No.
great. But on my DAW, when I'm doing stuff, it's got a humanize feature where it actually takes things out of sync, right? And you get to choose what percentage it doesn't line up. So it actually sounds like real people. And now we're trying to produce stuff that actually sounds like the computer. It's sort of backwards.
Yeah, the human
But when
element.
you listen to Mark, there's that human voice that's just, you know, it's, I don't know. It had such a deep impact on me. That was part of it. And spending a week having lessons with Tom Stevens was another totally mind-blowing experience.
And that's sort of in like a different way too, right? Because the way that Tom is thinking about music a lot of times is so smart and intelligent, the way he's looking at the way phrases go. Did he do that with you?
He did. And also at the same time, there was a there's a brutal honesty and directness on how he delivered. There was no filter. And I appreciated that. You know, if something was bad, you got the, that sucked. Why did you play that so crappy? Make it better. And you know, maybe it bruises the ego a tiny bit, but you need to hear that it's time to fix things. He didn't couch it at all. And maybe it was, you know, he was younger at the time. I don't, did you work with him at CV?
I did, yeah, did a little bit, and
Yeah. That's Chosen Veil for anybody that doesn't
yes,
know the shorthand.
yeah.
But yeah, I don't know whether that sort of whether that was that stayed into the later years or
He was
whether he got a
pretty
little
honest.
softer.
He was still pretty honest, but there was a little bit of humor behind it, I think.
Okay.
You know,
Yeah, I mean,
it was
you know,
a
he was still in LA when I was working with him, and you know, I mean, playing in the orchestra. And you know, there's like, don't be wasting my time here. You got the sense that, you know.
What kind of stuff was what would you remember what do you remember playing for Tom that week that
Well, first thing we worked on was the Henderson Variation movements, which the Silver album that of his. I mean, that whole album is just like ridiculous, but he owned that piece. And, you know, I wanted to be able to play it half as well as he did.
Yeah.
I was 19 at the time. So it was like, oh my gosh, you know, he was very kind with us. He was very generous with his time. And I still have an excerpt book with his old phone number that I'm sure he never had, you know, was gone like 5 years later, but, right. But he gave me his home number. Like if I had questions and you know, like that was pretty cool back in the day, you know? Especially when you couldn't email.
I know, back in the good old days before.
And I didn't actually call him and take advantage of that because I would have felt guilty taking more of his time. But like, you know, he realized that he was making an impression and that it wasn't really important to me to understand where he was coming from.
Did he introduce Stamp to you at all? Or was that?
Yeah. Oh yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So you were getting
that was it. It was Stamp and then Henderson and, I think that was what we did that week. It was a lot of Stamp. Yeah.
Wow. And then you mixed that with Gould and then you also had a brass quintet with some, who was the other trumpet player in this brass quintet at Juilliard?
Some guy named Sax.
Who's this guy?
I don't know. We were on a Zoom today together for an hour, just hanging.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's what we can do now that we're not really working. Actually, we were talking about Northwestern stuff because it's recruiting season. So Tom Rolfe was on the call too. But I mean, it's been great reconnecting with Mike. We always stayed connected, but then with the National Brass Ensemble recording and
now Northwestern.
And just this. And then when I brought him into Northwestern as part of the team, it was like, it was cool. It's cool, you know, that's another dude. It's like, how do you do that, man? You know, I hear him do stuff and physically it's like, it's miraculous.
You know, I remember him coming to my house. We were in Ohio when I was teaching in Akron and we were doing some violin and he said, "Yeah, I'm working on my slurs or something." And he said, "Oh, my legato tongue." I said, "Yeah, but you slurred that." He said, "No, this is slurred." What?
Yeah, I mean, physically, the stuff he does on the instrument is just, it's crazy. So we had a brass quintet together and, you know, it was big fun.
Wow. And so after you finished school at Juilliard, you're freelancing in New York, but there were a couple other people like Ray Mace, Alan Dean, Ed Carroll that were around. What kind of things did you pick up from those guys when you were starting?
Oh my gosh. I mean, it was, going to work was like a clinic. So Ed, for some reason, took me out as his second a lot because I'm sure I was a crummy second player, right? I'm a kid, you know, I was used to playing first. had to get rid of vibrato that I still use too much of sometimes. You know, I don't know. But for some reason, he was very kind. And then it was like we're playing some chamber orchestra. It was called Philharmonia Virtuosi of New York. And playing a Mozart symphony. And I was like, he's phrasing these bum-ba-dums. Oh my goodness. We always have to be musicians. Because how many times when you're playing, you know, you're going bum, bum, ba-bum in a Mozart piano concerto or something. But he was turning it into art. And it was like, all right, I'm stealing that.
Right.
And then, you know, playing in the New York Trumpet Ensemble with him and a guy named Jeff Kernow. I don't know where he is now. He's 1 mile from me, actually. Less than a mile away. We're neighbors, and I know we hang, and it's just
there's some great recording amazing out from that period too. That
we did some fun stuff, but that was like listening to Ed play some stuff, and learning how he thinks about music. You know, he's a deep thinker. He really is, and that's one of the reasons that he's had such a really meaningful impact, especially on modern music, because he gets it. He gets how to take the hieroglyphics on that page and turn it into art. It's not easy, and he's got a real way of thinking about it and approaching it. That's cool. Gigging some with Ray Mace, that was like listening and going, a trumpet can articulate that well?
Right.
I got to go home. I got to do some work. I got to work. How do you do that? You know, and then just listening again to the ease that he brought and then going and hearing him play in the quintet. It was just like, my goodness, you know?
Yeah.
It just pretty stunning stuff. And then Alan and I played in the Paul Whiteman band together.
Really?
So we toured a lot doing the 1924 Alien Hall concert, which had the premiere of Rhapsody in Blue on it. And it was a recreation of that concert. So the first half was just the Whiteman band. And then the second half was the Whiteman band with some violins, just the way it was done in 1924. So we were playing, you know, stuff with Dick Hyman playing stride piano, and we're doing Zez Confrey tunes and just all this old 20s jazz stuff. And Alan is the ultimate chameleon. He can play anything. You know, I remember an ITG where in the morning he played with Calliope and he was playing shams and cornettos and then did a New York brass quintet concert that night. It's like my chops would have been so confused, right? But he just puts it, you know, crosses his legs, leans back and plays, and it's like the most effortless thing. But just the ability to play so many styles. I mean, it's right. Like, oh my gosh. So it was like a clinic, and then subbing with the Philharmonic and sitting next to Phil Smith. It was like, that was another one. It's like, how does this guy sound when he plays loud? It's like three guys playing mezzo forte. It just gets bigger and broader and more radiant.
Yeah.
How does he do that? I don't know the answer yet, but you get that in your ear and it makes you go on a quest, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, well, all those guys you mentioned, I mean, the impact that they've all had. I mean, Ed has taught so many people and he's had such a positive impact. And Alan Dean, I mean, New York Brass Quintet, plus all the cornetto stuff, plus he's a good jazz player, plus St. Louis Brass Quintet, and then Ray Mace with everything with ABQ and Orpheus. I mean, that's a huge, you were around the eye of the storm, really, in that era.
Well, ABQ and Orpheus and New York City Ballet. No one
right. Oh, yeah,
remembers that he played principal in that group for decades.
Yes.
I mean, he could sit in the orchestra. And I remember going, like, when a student, I'd go to the Philharmonic and they'd be doing Mahler 6 or something, and there's Ray sitting there on fifth trumpet. You know, it's like, you know, first call world, right? He could do anything.
Yeah, and so humble about it, too.
No, just a wonderful, wonderful man. And they're all, and that's the thing. And like, first time I was in subbing in the Philharmonic, John Ware is like, he comes over and he just shows me the ropes. And okay, kid, you don't want to do this. You want, you know, here's where, you know.
Wow. That's interesting, and, too. You were around Ware, because I always thought he was really ahead of his time with the way he played, too.
It was a style that would fit today. Which isn't necessarily the case of everybody from his era.
Right, right. So so what kind of things did you learn as a freelancer in that period that you would, because I mean, obviously not everybody's going to win an orchestra job. A lot of us are going to be freelancers. You know, when you look back at that period, what kind of things do you kind of impart to students or just in general to people who are doing that?
Well, I'd like to impart more of this to students. Most of the students are like, I got to work up Don Juan. Oh, how do I play the, you know, it's all like, it's all about the audition, you know, the orchestra audition. Well, first of all, every lesson you learn, you're going to find some use for. So playing in jazz band at University of Illinois, playing in the Kids from Wisconsin, that commercial stuff. When I was in New York, I was subbing Broadway shows. I was playing in a Monday night rehearsal band. So I got to play at the Blue Note. You know, it's like, I'm not a jazz player, but I can play one night a week, you know, and I'm not playing the jazz chair, but, you know, it was like, who was playing lead in the band? Well, you know, some nights it was Lou Soloff. Some nights it was Mike Mossman, who's just, I don't know if you know Mike, but what a player. And another guy who freelances in New York, Dominique Duras, was playing in the band, and Lou Marini was lead alto. He was playing the Saturday Night Live band and was in the Blues Brothers, right?
Wow.
And you know, it was Anthony Jackson on bass, and sometimes Kenwood Denard was playing drums. It was all these like big heavyweight guys playing, and there I am sitting up playing fourth trumpet or third trumpet, because the band leader wanted people that could put out sound in the middle register to be, you know, he tended towards more legit guys who could play the style for those chairs. He didn't, you know, it was fine that I wasn't going to move over and play lead or take the solos. But to be able to sit there and listen to that and be around folks doing that sort of creative stuff was a lesson. Playing commercial jingles, being able to play opera, play ballet, know those licks, know how to, what the difference is between being in a pit and being on a stage. Mm-hmm. And it is different. And then realizing that a lot of the time when you're freelancing, it's a different sound than you want to make when you're auditioning for the Philharmonic.
Right.
It's leaner. It blends more. It's and knowing that whole chameleon thing, you know, you want to be a chameleon. You want to be able to play. If you're playing in a 35 piece chamber orchestra, you better play the trumpet different than when you're playing, you know, in a 100 piece orchestra. You've got to know the context,
right?
And that's something to learn. Really, it's good to learn early. It's good to learn sometime,
right?
And I know that, you know, when I was first freelancing in New York, I think I was probably accused of being too orchestral.
Mm-hmm.
And then I just conjured up. I always loved playing solos and had won some solo competitions. And I'm like, well, why don't you play like a soloist instead?
Right.
And that worked really well as a, you know, or a brass quintet player. You know, those kinds of things in freelance are important. And know the importance of the pecking order. Know who's, have respect for your elders.
Mm-hmm.
You know, even if, you know, that what's the old Major League Baseball saying? If you're a star, be kind to the people who are coming up because you're going to pass them on the way down. Right?
Yeah.
You know, you may think you're the next big thing, but you're not yet. And you have to have respect for the folks who have been doing it and realize you can learn from them.
Right. Right.
Be a sponge.
Yeah. You know?
I hope to still be learning. I learn stuff from, you know, every day about what's going on. I was talking to Marcus Printup last night. I was picking his brain on stuff. You know, it's like, you know, I listen to him play and I go like, how do you do that? Can you give me a hint?
He was up at 4 a.m. playing Giant Steps.
Something like that. Yeah. Well, we were actually talking late, but, always have your ears open, you know, yeah. Don't get locked into one way of playing.
He's a great example of that because he's always asking questions. He's wanting new stuff all the time. And
oh, he's amazing. He's an amazing person, amazing human being.
Absolutely. Yeah, there's just so many people to learn from all the time. So that's, yeah. You know.
And, you know, and I think taking advantage of that when you're freelancing, because one of the things that happens, I think, once you get a symphony orchestra job is that you're all of a sudden part of one big dysfunctional family, but you end up playing most of your concerts with the same people all the time, right. Which has an advantage musically because you know what people are going to do. You know how to react. And that's one of the reasons that orchestras that play a lot of concerts a year can tend to sound really good no matter who's on the podium. It's better when we have a great conductor, but you could put somebody just okay up front and it's still going to sound like that band because the musicians are used to playing together. You know, they don't have to look up. They can put the feelers out and you know what somebody's going to do. You know what the first horns, how they're going to phrase something. You know, like, I know what Nitsan's going to do on the trombone or Matt Vaughn if he's playing first. You know, we just know. I mean, you know, it's like there's, you know.
You're used to their language.
I get that.
Yeah.
The downside to that is that you don't have the input from a lot of new blood. And that's why teaching is cool. That's why doing something like National Brass Ensemble was cool. That's why doing the All-Star Orchestra was so much fun when I did that, because, you know, it was like so many new folks and making music with different people in a different way. And that's one of the joys of freelance, is that you get to make music with different people all the time. The drag is you don't have medical insurance. Right. You don't have the regular paycheck, but there's a freshness to being in the scene and working with different people and having a chance to create more. Well, I was talking with Brandon Ridenour. I had him in to do a class a couple months ago, and you know, just the work he does with founders, I think is fascinating.
Yeah.
You know, just the way to be creative and be, you know, doing stuff that it's not somebody in an office putting up a program that you have to play.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's creating like that. I think that's just fascinating. I just love that.
It helps when you can play a
brand. But I also love my job. Don't get me wrong. I'm fine to have, I mean, I serve on the orchestra committee, the artistic committee right now, where we talk about programming, but we don't really have a say. we get to go, oh, that's interesting. I better practice. You know, there's a joy to that too, especially in non-pandemic times where you get to see a schedule and you know what you're going to be doing that year. You can practice it over the summer, get yourself in a groove, figure out what your year is going to look like and go. But it does take some of that outside the box thinking away.
Right.
And it's one of the advantages of not being locked into a job.
Right. Other than the health insurance is good on the job.
Well, yeah. And retirement pay and like vacation. When I got my first job in Dallas, it was like, we get paid not to come to work sometimes, because it was coming from such a gig mentality. It's like, oh, I never took a vacation, because what if you got called for a gig? You're out of town. You're going to miss out.
$150 is gone.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, yeah, that $40 brass quintet job under the Brooklyn Bridge, yeah, with pigeons. It's like, gosh, I would have missed that.
Well,
yeah, actually, you think I'm kidding.
I don't think you're kidding.
It was a musician's performance trust fund job under the Brooklyn Bridge.
$40.
I think it was $40 back then.
Wow. That's what you do.
Yeah. 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 No, but I had fun. Are you kidding? Yeah. We got to pick our own program.
Yeah, that can be fun.
Yeah.
You know. Well, what about when you were in New York also, you did the Young Concert Artist series and you won the competition?
Well, it was Concert Artist Guild.
Different
than YCA. Yeah, they've had two trumpet players now who have won it, the other being Brandon Ridenour. And so Brandon won 29 years after I did. So probably in another like 20 something years, they'll be ready for another trumpet.
Yeah.
Actually, James Vaughn and Ansel Norris were both did well in that competition last year. But
not a surprise. Not a surprise.
Two young folks with really strong voices as well.
Can you talk about, because not long after that, you won Dallas, right?
Uh-huh, yeah.
So can you kind of talk about maybe how that process of having to be convincing to win that competition helped you with the audition phase?
Yeah, I'm.
Or did it?
It did. Oh, no, everything did. I'm trying to put this in a way that doesn't sound awful.
Okay.
But I think in 1988,
mm-hmm.
Orchestras were looking for, especially in principal players, a combination of solid playing and personal playing.
Mm-hmm.
I hope places are still looking that way. But I'm not 100% convinced that all places are looking that way right now.
Right.
You know, if it's skewed one way, it's been towards the big sound, totally accurate, you know, drive the fairway, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But isn't it great to see someone like slice around a dog leg, you know, instead of just placing it straight in the fairway and then, I don't know. I don't golf. What's better? I don't know. But so I think in that era, that combination of my orchestral training and the experiences I was having as a soloist put me in a really good place to do well in that audition.
Yeah.
And honestly, you know, it was a toss up. There were two of us that went and played. They did two services that day that were trial for principal trumpet, and they had both of us at both services trading halves of the rehearsal.
I can only guess who the other person was.
It was Mike Sachs. You know, and here we are, like, we've been roommates at Summer Festival. We played a brass quintet together, and I would have been totally fine with Mike winning. And you know, at that point, I think it just came down to, you know, they were probably flipping a coin because Mike, you know, come on, it's ridiculous. It's great playing always. But I think, you know, they were looking for that soloistic stuff, and Mike had been coming from playing a couple of years in the section in Houston. Mm-hmm. I think it worked out pretty well for Mike.
He did okay.
Right. And I didn't, you know, I was pretty fresh in Dallas when the Cleveland job opened up. I didn't take that audition because I was still really learning about the orchestra business in Dallas, and I was happy there. I was, you know, it's a great group of people, and it was exciting, and it was good. And I didn't know if I was quite in a place where I was ready for that job in Cleveland, and clearly Mike was.
Yeah.
So I mean, it worked out great for both of us, but it was good to be in such a solid orchestra, getting to stretch my voice. I'd come in as co-principal. Rick Giangiulio was principal, and then you know, he'd made the decision to, he asked if we could switch us up. So he went to co, and I got to play a little more lead. You know, he was feeling like, you know, time to do some other stuff. He loves to conduct. He's got trump corps mutes.
Yeah.
You know, it was sort of like, he felt like it was a good decision for him, and who was I to say, wow, thank you for this opportunity. I'll take it. You know, I'll run with it and see what I can do. But I had some lessons to learn down there, and it was great to do that in that place. It's a safe place with,
yeah,
you know, beautiful musicians and an orchestra that allowed, you know, exploration.
Yeah.
In a beautiful way. And then again, you know, for Kernow to be there after me and then Ryan after that, you're talking about a history there then of players. And Rick also more of a soloistic kind of player. So that really, I think, put me in a good stead there and allowed me to sort of work on how to be a soloist in the tooties.
Right.
Which is, you know, that's, yeah, you know.
What were things in your playing that you noticed that changed by having that job? I mean, from practice schedules to the way you approach the repertoire or volume or any of those things, did those come into play?
Oh, well, you know, more direct, you know, louder, more, you know, blocky in the 2D stuff. I mean, when you're doing freelancing in New York, going from playing the Paul Whiteman band to playing chamber orchestra to playing even extra with the Philharmonic, it's usually off stage, you know. Right. It's different than cranking it out on stage, right? And playing a Bruckner symphony or playing something where you have to be massive and broad. So definitely I had to add that.
Yeah.
There were some rhythmic components to it as well, to be able to sit in the band instead of feeling like you're like sort of fleet on top sometimes, you know, like sitting into it. And then you realize maybe I shouldn't sit so far back because we're always late. We're in the back row. But, you know, feeling like, I don't know, it's a bigger, it's a bigger bus, right?
Yeah.
Right. So that's a different feeling.
Yeah.
And not a lot, not, you know, some differences. But then I got to Philly and the orchestra was literally like twice as loud. That was a big difference.
Yeah.
And the schedule was twice as hard.
Now,
that was a much bigger difference going from Dallas to Philly than it was going from freelancing to Dallas.
Okay. Well, talk about the preparation for Philly because you were still playing principal in Dallas. I know there were a lot of late nights, you know, getting ready for that. You talk about like your preparation, like, what's your process, first of all? I think it would be a good thing for people to know.
Well, I mean, you know, that was my last audition, and it was 26 years ago. So my process, I don't know what I would do today. But back then, it was like make sure the trumpet playing is in a good place and trust the excerpts. And this is something I work with. I talk about with my students. If you understand the style of the excerpts and you know the tunes, if you compare the difficulty of most excerpts with the difficulty of the solo rep we play or the etudes we play, the excerpts are easy.
Right.
They really are. Once you know how a Mahler symphony is supposed to go, or you know what, how to articulate Stravinsky, you know, it's not that complicated. Note for note, I mean, string players look at like the Leonard calls and they go like, "It's an arpeggio. Why is that an excerpt?" It's like, because it's an arpeggio. No, it's you know, do you make the right sound? Do you have like, you know, and we analyze that and we.
Listen,
you know, don't get me started. It's like, oh my goodness, you know, a student comes in and they've got 73 markings on every note, and it's like, it's a B flat arpeggio, man. Can you just play? You know, like, where's your whiteout? Because the eraser isn't going to cut it. Like, can we just take all that out? But getting the trumpet playing in a good place. So getting out the Arban book, getting out etude books, playing Charlier, playing. Right now, I'm doing a ton of Bousquet because it's what I torture my freshmen with, and I want to be able to torture myself a little bit. And you know what? I found that after doing a bunch of Bousquet, my articulation's better, my low register's better, all the stuff that I want my students to have. Oh, okay. You know, beginning of pandemic, I started going through the Arban book, like, you know, in a new, you know, just like sort of like the way I did it in seventh grade. You know, it's like, oh, I'm going to revisit this. Do that kind of thing. Make sure your trumpet playing is in a good shape. You can get around the horn. You've got flexibility. You've got clear articulation. You can move around. It's even top to bottom. The excerpts. How long do you really need to work up the excerpts? If you know the tunes.
Yeah. Right.
So that was my process, especially at that point, was to work on the trumpet playing, then work on the tunes. But yeah. Not very much. That came mostly at the end. And then, you know, it was before like cool cell phones and tablets and computers weren't personal. You know, there's no laptops. It was like big clunky things on your desk. So I used index cards and I would have the list of all the excerpts. And then there was the, this is good pile and this is crummy pile. And then hopefully you put more into the good pile and you play that as a list. And if stuff didn't go well, you take it out and put it back in the crummy file and, you know, and just polish the stuff that you're not good at. I mean, the secret to playing, figure out, and this is, you know, I got to credit Barbara Butler and her list on this, like here's the 20 things from like rate your best to your worst. Well, what you want to do is make sure the stuff that is your worst is still at a professional level. And then you got to highlight that stuff that's at the top that you're really good at, because that's what's going to bring the magic. It's going to separate you. The other stuff knocks you out. Maximizing what you're really good at is the stuff that makes you noticed.
And probably builds confidence too, right?
Well, yeah. And then you know that you can shine on certain excerpts, and then you know that the other ones that maybe used to give you trouble, you can get through just fine.
Yeah.
You're not wasting opportunities. Every, you know, if you've got five excerpts to play, every note's an opportunity.
Right.
It's not running a gauntlet. It's taking advantage of the notes that we're given. That sounds like Gandalf from Lord of the Rings.
That does sound philosophical yet Hollywood all at the same time.
No, but it's true. I mean, you know, five excerpts or four excerpts in a prelim, you want to impress. You want to show them what you've got in those excerpts. You go on autopilot for one excerpt, you've just blown like 20% of your chances right there.
Right.
Which is why, you know, on Trumpet Herald, somebody will bash an audition. I played note perfect. I didn't miss a thing and I didn't make the cut. I know, but was it special? And that's the whole idea of like, but I didn't miss any notes. Well, that should sort of, you know, if you're playing four or five excerpts, maybe hopefully that's a given.
Right.
But if it's a semi or a final, it's probably okay to miss a note or two. As long as the other ones are really special, you know?
Do you remember after you won, did anybody make any comments about why you got the job?
In Philly?
Mm-hmm.
They liked the post-horn solo.
Mm-hmm.
They liked, and it's funny because I grew up, you know, obviously listening to Herseth, as I mentioned before, but I grew up listening to Philadelphia Orchestra recordings with Gil Johnson. and folks had a sense of nostalgia for Gil when I was playing. And in my first year or two, when some of the string players came up and complimented me in comparing me to what Gil had done, that was really moving to me, because I thought he was something very, very special. Yeah. If you listen to his Blumina, it's like, oh my gosh, just makes you cry, you know.
Or his Pines off stage is beautiful.
Exactly. I mean, there's stuff that he did that was just.
Did you meet him after you got the job?
No. No, Frank Hadarabic had been here for 20 years when I got the job. So.
Yeah. So we were talking about what changed in your playing when you went to Philly, and it was twice as loud, you know.
It's trying to get the projection and the power without engaging physicality in a negative way.
Right.
I mean, you know, leaving the upper chest and the shoulders out of it, and I fall into it sometimes, and I can feel myself, you know, compressing in a really not great way, and that usually makes getting to the end of the symphony more difficult than if you're just relying on the air, well, you know, in a more relaxed way south of the chin, you know, just blow and feel like the air is moving straight through.
Well, I wanted to ask too about, as far as the physical impact of the different halls you played in, because you went from the Academy of Music to the Kimmel Center. So did I say that right? Yeah, I think so, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So how did that impact the way you played and the physicality of it and the way the brass section played?
Yeah, it's interesting because the Academy, the best seats in the house were on the stage. So we heard really well across. You know, you could hear fourth horn, you could hear last stand of first violins all the way over. You could hear last stand of cellos. I mean, it was there was this connection, dry and dead.
Yeah.
Right. So yeah. The string players had to play with this incredible draw through the bow to create resonance, because the room didn't help.
Right.
It was totally honest room, but it wasn't providing that Hollywood sweetness. Right.
Right.
And then in the brass, you had to sustain in a way that would carry and that would, again, provide that resonance in the longer term. And because of the depth of the stage, we were really far from the apron. So right. We were a mile from the audience. So you had to play. It was physical.
Yeah.
It was physical. Then we got in the Kimmel, and it was like, you know, that was the average conductor. You know, if you played the way you did in the Academy, they'd look back with horror and go, you know, it became really clear that especially Maestro Savalas did not want to hear that kind of a sound that worked really well in the Academy, that we couldn't do that on stage at the Kimmel. That right. It has to be less front, rounder sound.
Yeah.
But then with, interestingly enough, with Yannick Nazet-Séguin, our current music director, who has a choral background and loves the radiant sound, there are times where he wants it more driven.
Mm-hmm.
So now it's more like halfway in between where the adjustment that had to be made. They've also changed the room a little bit. They've added some more deadening behind the stage, because it used to be a cement thing, like direct cement thing behind us, and it would just boom. It was like a cannon shot out of there. So now they've got some deadening back behind us, and now we can play with a little bit more, you know, directness sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
So it's more like halfway in between.
Well, you know, it's talking about the different music directors you've had. Can you kind of talk about you've had Savalas, Eschenbach, and now Yannick, and then
Dutoit.
And Dutoit, I'm sorry, yes.
He wasn't a music director. He was a music advisor for 4 years, but he was in between Eschenbach and because Christoph left us rather abruptly. We had tried to get him to stay longer, but he cut the weeks and he was on to another challenge, and we needed a bridge to find the next music director. And fortunately, musically, fortunately, Dutoit was there to fill that void. I mean, he had his other problems, and we won't go into why he's been canceled, because that was unfortunate for the music, but well-deserved from what I understand.
So, yeah. You guys did do great.
I don't know what it is with these geniuses, but, you know, come on, guys. Get it together.
That's true.
No, I'm serious. It's like there's...
There's no reason for that.
Yeah. This is a community. We're all humans. We got to treat each other well. Yeah. But in any case... those four have been the music, the main podium folks.
Can you talk about playing for each one of them and what you think their demands were? How are they similar? How were they different? What changed with
your... Savalish was it was a dream. It was like I those 9 years that I played for him, I learned like every single day. You know, it's like, oh my gosh, it's just... First week was, not excluding opening night, which was Beethoven 2. We were doing Beethoven 7. It was a Beethoven year. Like, isn't every year a Beethoven year? But whatever.
250 of them.
Yeah, but this was like 225 or something. You know, it was like, it was like, okay, it was some anniversary of something. But we were touring Japan with, we did all 9 symphonies in a row over a week and a half in Suntory Hall in Tokyo. It was like, that also was life-changing, playing them in order, to hear the compositional flow of that. I don't know. That sounds really geeky. I should shut up about that. But for the symphony, he would sing the phrase and then start conducting, and everybody was to come in. It wasn't, hey, we're starting 4 before T, or we're going to start in measure 273. It would be like, dee da 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 dum, and then he would start conducting, and you had to know where that was. And I was like, "Is this a party trick? Because everybody's coming in. Did I not get the memo?" And but there was such an understanding, a depth of understanding of core repertoire, that core Central European repertoire: Beethoven, Mozart, Brahms, Dvorak. It was Haydn. I mean, my gosh.
I should ask when
Strauss doing tone poems with him. It was like, you know, it was like channeling Strauss. It was just so awesome. It was just absolutely awesome.
You know, I love the recordings of the Strauss, because the Heldenleben recording has the alternate ending too, which is never played.
Yeah, I know. Isn't that crazy?
Yeah. Yeah. For people that don't know those recordings, those are fantastic Strauss recordings.
Yeah. And, you know, it was old school. I mean, he definitely wanted us to sound more like a European orchestra.
Yeah.
So there was a roundness to the brass approach that he was looking for, that resonated with me. It's probably one of the reasons I got the job, is that he liked what I was bringing with that.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause it suits my soul a little bit better. But it was a great fit. But we also did amazing Bruckner symphonies with him. One year we did a Bruckner 5. You know, who does Bruckner 5, right? We do 4, we do 7, we do 8, you know? But who does a 5? And we did it at Carnegie Hall, and the New York Times picked it as like the classical music concert of the year in their year in review. That was strange.
What was that? That might have been me shuffling papers on my keyboard.
Okay.
I was trying to move it.
But, you know, just the way he could make Bruckner, you know, he's a formalist. So you understood when it was first theme, second theme, when it was development, where the coda started. I mean, it was like so clear in construction. And he just let the music speak. It was glorious.
Yeah.
Playing Haydn concerto with him. He liked slow tempos, and the Tomasi I did with him, he liked slow tempos. I mean, he was 70 something, and the joints weren't moving quite as oiled up as they were when he was younger. But it was also went with that Central European kind of, you know, he's from outside of Munich and spent most of his career in the opera house. You know, there's a different psyche for that.
Was that Tomasi, by the way, the first time Philly had played that piece?
Oh yeah. Yeah. Wow. Yeah, I was talking with his wife, Mechtilde, and because we did it on tour in South America. and on the West Coast, and we were just making small talk, which was never easy with the Savalishes, either of them. Although Maestro was like one of the funniest dudes out there. He just never let it out. And when he did, it was like these one-liners that would just leave you just, I know, it was hilarious. But she said, "Yes, my husband does not think this is important music." That was Tomasi.
Ouch.
It's like, yeah, it's not important to you, but it's sort of important to me.
Thanks so much.
You know, it's not Brahms piano concerto, you know, or Beethoven violin concerto, but come on. I mean, okay, we listen to a Prokofiev violin concerto and you go, okay, well, okay, trumpet music sucks, but it's still fun. Can I play two? You know,
right.
You know, or even Mozart horn concerto, you know, our stuff is, you know, you got to go into the modern stuff and that's harder to get them to program, but that's, we already talked about that.
Yeah.
But Savalish was, you know, he was like the old Kapellmeister, you know, all the old genius. I mean, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
It was sad when he had to retire. It was for health reasons, you know.
Yeah. There's a lot
not
of
not because of his mind. He was ready to go, but the body just wasn't.
When some of those YouTube clips are really great, there's still some stuff on YouTube I've seen of you guys playing.
There's a Don Juan from somewhere. Yeah. It was somewhere on tour. It's just, you know, that's what I'm talking about. And it's just, wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
And doing Domestica on tour was just so much fun. Taking Strauss, he loved to tour with Strauss, you know.
You had some third trumpet player playing Domestica.
Yeah, some guy, Chris Martin. I don't know where he is now. He was, yeah.
Maybe it worked out. So talk about... And so then Eschenbach was after this.
Yeah.
So talk a little bit about the Eschenbach years and what.
Sorry, I can't hear you. What were you saying?
Okay.
No, he's a nice man. He is a very good musician. He's a beautiful pianist, and it just wasn't a good fit for us. Right. And there's no blame on either side. We tried. He tried. It just didn't. I don't know, somehow it just didn't work. And it was sad.
Yeah.
Because I really like the guy.
Yeah.
And I think he's you hear him play the piano and you go, well, he's a genius. Yeah, he's beautiful.
Yeah.
Beautiful musician. Somehow, as Gail Williams put it, I don't think he can dance. There was something about the way he moves when he conducts that just the motions didn't correlate for us. And I think in some ways we were too reactive, so he would hint at slowing down and we would slow down, and he didn't want that. He just was slowing down a little, like his arms weren't moving as quick. I don't
Gail was working, by the way.
But it really felt it was hard. Music making was hard, and I think he felt it too, and that's sort of one of the reasons that it ended when it did, is that, you know, it just didn't
yeah,
I don't know. I mean, it's like, oh, look, that person is beautiful. I think I'll marry them. Yeah, but you don't know them. And that's sort of what happens when you get a music director. It's like, you don't know what it's like on that day to day. You don't know how it works.
Right.
And it just wasn't the right, it wasn't the right partner.
Right.
You know?
And then there was the period with Dutrois, which put out a great Alpine Symphony.
You know, Dutrois, for all of his shortcomings, which were personal,
right,
was a great musician, and he had like over 1,000 pieces of repertoire. He could do anything, and he didn't like being typecast as the guy who did French music. First of all, he's Swiss, not French, right?
Right.
So he would, I'm Swiss, I'm not French, I'm Swiss, you know? He would go into this, and it's like, yes, we know, you grew up 40 kilometers from where Honegger was born. We got it, okay? But he could do that big stuff. He could do Mahler symphonies. I mean, he had this sense of architecture. Yeah, very different sense of architecture from what Savalish had, you know, because they came from different points of view. But the same gift for making hour-long pieces clear.
Yeah.
And he also had a lack of affect.
Yeah.
So he just let the music go. He wasn't into like doing all like micromanaging. That's right. Like some folks do. And it really worked. And it was a great match for us. He had done literally hundreds of concerts with us before he did those 4 years. I mean, I don't know what the number is. I wouldn't have been surprised if he had done 300 concerts with us.
Wow.
Because he was music director of our summer series, both at the Mann Music Center and in Saratoga Springs.
Right.
So we were used to seeing him for 9 weeks a year anyway. So it wasn't a big stretch to turn that into 15, right? Or 17 or 18. We did a Britain War Requiem, which is, I think, one of the most powerful pieces ever written. Mm-hmm. And it was just like, oh my gosh, this is art. You know, it's not every day that sometimes you go, great music. And sometimes you just go, what was I just a part of? That was art.
Yeah.
You know, the highest art. And we had some of those moments with Dutoit.
Yeah. And then now you have a very exciting conductor in Yannick.
Yeah, Yannick is a quintessential 21st century guy because he is public. He is, he does everything. You know, loves opera, loves symphonic music, listens to Bjork. I mean, you know, it's like, you know, he knows all the, he knows pop music. He,
yeah. He's a good face for the orchestra. I mean, in so many ways.
Well, but he's also a really sublime musician, and he brings. It's a different approach, and what's interesting is that it's not a singular approach. So it's not like you fall back on one style of organizing music. For him, it's okay. We did a series of requiems, and because of his choral background, it was amazing. Doing Verdi Requiem was cool. And also there's you do opera, you better know Verdi. You know how Verdi goes, right? But Mozart Requiem, totally different approach because it's totally different music.
Right.
He's informed, really informed about early music. So when we do a Messiah with him or do some Bach or do Mozart with him, it really is... not copying early instruments, but it's informed by that. The colors he goes for, the way, the leanness in it. It doesn't sound like the orchestra would have under Ormandy. It would have sounded like a Rachmaninoff orchestra playing Mozart.
Right.
Now we sound like Academy of Ancient Music on modern instruments more. That, you know, it's deep.
Yeah.
But he's approachable, and he's somebody... When I was doing my column for ITG Journal, it took me 4 months to get an appointment with him. They gave me 15 minutes scheduling people. And
yeah.
Then he spent an hour talking about how he views the trumpet's role in the orchestra. And I got two columns out of it, two for the price of one. It was gorgeous.
No, those were great.
You know, and he was very, very outgoing with it. And when I was raising funds for my Afghan trumpet friend to come study with the States, he was the first guy to say, let me get $5,000.
Wow.
I want this to succeed. I want him to be able to go to Interlaken. Let me give you $5,000. And then the board chair of the orchestra was like, I'll give $5,000 too. And all of a sudden we're like, wow, I'm a third of the way to that goal. That's really cool. Thanks, Yannick, you know? And Rich, the board chair at the time. And I'm not sure there's a lot of music directors that would do that. And then when my Afghan friend Baset came to Philadelphia, great pictures with Yannick. Yannick wanted to meet him. And, you know, it's like there's this personality and personal connection with people that there's not that separation between maestro and everybody else that maybe was a generation or two removed. So Yannick he's the perfect 21st century music director.
Yeah.
And he's also not a jerk. So, I mean, you know.
Well, there seem to be a couple.
On a personal level, he's a good guy, right? How does that even work? I don't know.
It makes you want to play for them even more when they're like that. So
yeah, I miss music, making music. Yeah, right now.
And I do want to come back to the Baset thing in just a minute. I had two other questions before that, and then I promise I'll let you relax for the rest of the night after getting.
You mean I can change my grapefruit juice out for something else that usually goes in this?
You can do that the whole time. It's totally fine. As long as the Benadryl is working on my dog, we're doing great.
Okay, super.
So. And since you're in Philadelphia, it made me think about Allen Iverson because I wanted to talk to you about practice.
We show up.
there's that. So can you talk right now about like in a normal time, what is your warm up? What is your how do you start your day? What's the normal situation for you?
Well, the normal situation is I've got fairly young kids right now. I've got a 9-year-old and a 1-year-old. She was born 10 days before the lockdown last March. So that's been a little crazy. But it's like, get Andreas to school and then get the horn out. So 8:15, between 8:15 and 8:30, I'm down in the practice room doing the stuff. And then I'll do a regular full routine at home and then drive downtown to the hall and do a second short warm up before rehearsal.
What's normally in your warm-up right now?
Yeah, I mean, it's the same stuff you do, right?
Yeah. It's
The same stuff everybody does. Okay, so I start, I know it's controversial, but I start on the mouthpiece, do a little buzzing.
You're gonna get canceled for that.
Yeah, well, I mean, though, I know there are some people who don't do it, and I respect them for that. I mean, not everything works for everybody. So when I teach students about mouthpiece, we talk about why we do it, what the goals are, what the sound is, because if you try to make that really clear sound, then you don't use your real embouchure, and then it is destructive. But for some people, it just doesn't work, and that's cool. But it works for me, and it works for a lot of people that happen to have good jobs, which makes me think maybe it's okay. But I do some mouthpiece stuff, and then I get out the trumpet, and it's a combination of, yeah, it's actually. Oftentimes, I'll start off with doing some Chickowitz flow studies, just the ones from the very beginning of the book. The ba da da dee da da da. But I'll do some bends in it. Da dee da dee da. But so it's sacrilege. I know I'm not playing them the way they were intended. But I'll sort of morph those into doing a little bit of lip bending and a little bit of Chickowitz. Or I'll do sometimes just some Caruso bends. And I'll alternate that with sometimes stamps. So I don't do the same exact thing, but they accomplish the same thing early in the warm up. Some flexibility, and then go right into sort of pick and choose from the Ray Mace 10-week practice guide, which is just things taken from Clark and Schlossberg and Arban and Goldman practical studies. And it's really pretty much a cornet-based warm up in terms of where the notes come from.
And how long
Of course, flexibility is in there, and I do B flat trumpet, and then switch to the C like the last 10 minutes. Because for me, if I get the B flat trumpet working in that center and get a nice sound on the B flat and get it to be lithe so I can move around on it, then the C feels really easy.
What do you so what are your books that you like out of flexibility right now? Colin, I know because of the
Yeah, I mean, I always did Colin, but at Northwestern we agreed on Bilin because some of the other guys like that better, and because it was when we put together the team, we agreed on a curriculum so that we work out of the same books with the students. So there's this, it's one path.
Well, that was my next question was about Northwestern because for people that don't realize or have been under a rock for the past couple of years, it's you that was the start of it, and Tom Rolfes and Mike Sachs. Three great players, three guys that play really well together, obviously, because of the National Brass Ensemble and all of that. How do you guys work that as a team so the students can kind of see what works and what the crossover is and what the
Yeah, we actually have a fourth teacher, Channing Philbrick, who,
Enchanting, I'm sorry, I should
yeah,
totally
Channing, who's
enchant.
Chicago Lyric Opera, and he does the office hours as well. And we each take a quarter of the load. So in the best of all possible worlds, we'll rotate through. So we're each there once a month. Channing, obviously, with the office hours, is there every week doing some stuff, signing out horns as well as teaching, doing that organizational stuff. Thank goodness, right? All that stuff that makes the job be that much harder. But we agreed on a curriculum, and now obviously, it's personalized for every student because you don't teach everybody the same way because people have different needs and are starting at different places as freshmen and whatever. But we agreed on what books we were going to work out of. And then the student writes a lesson report. They record their lesson and they write a report, which is what their goals had been for that lesson, what was prepared for that lesson, what they played in the lesson, what they learned from the lesson, and then what's assigned for the next lesson and what the goals are in those pieces. It's great for the students because they then have to be intentional about what they're working on and why and how, because they have to actually delineate that on paper for the next week. And then they actually are supposed to print it out, although some bring it on a computer, but print it out and put it in a notebook. And then at the end of 4-year undergrad, you've got 120 sheets of paper that show you your progression. Wouldn't that be a cool thing to have?
Yeah.
Or, you know, you have 60 of those if you do your master's, right?
Right.
And then you hand that paper to the teacher the next week. They know what had happened the previous week, what was assigned, why it was assigned, and what to listen for. And then we text each other and call each other and all the time and email about, like, hey, did you notice this about so-and-so? Hey, we're working on this. Hey, so-and-so had a great lesson today. It's really a breakthrough with this. Or need to light a fire under so-and-so because they weren't quite prepped enough this week, and you know who you are. So we really expend a lot of energy to make sure we track progress and that it is a single line forward. The only reason we knew it was going to work is because the trombone studio has been doing that there for years. They have five trombone teachers, and they rotate through. Now, Mick Mulcahy does maybe 40% of it, and then the other folks come in, you know, a week here, a week there. But it's patterned after that. They do the same lesson report thing, and it's worked amazingly. I was 100% sure it would work for master's students. I was hoping it would work for undergrads, and it's been awesome.
Yeah. Yeah.
When I was approached about putting the team together, the first thing I said was to the dean, Tony Marie Montgomery, I said, Tony Marie, it's got to work for the students. That's number one. And two is it's got to make our lives not suck. Right. So we had to be able to manage schedules. And all of us are taking more weeks off the orchestra than we had before so that we aren't trying to do a mad dash to Chicago and come back and play a concert week. So we tend to go there mostly on weeks where we're off.
Right.
Mike can drive from Cleveland, which is different, but both Tom and I taking flights in and getting in and out of Chicago, it burns a little bit more time just commuting. And so we're tending to take weeks mostly to do it, or booking it during what were vacation weeks as well, because those are interspersed during the season. It's worked great.
Yeah, because when you're there, you're there.
You know? I mean, the students get the time. They do. And what's been nice is I think people that the students who might have been worried going in, how is this going to work, also realize that we're available. So when we're done here, I have to actually go find some music and scan it and send it to somebody because it's on back order. I don't believe in infringing on copyright, but it's back order stuff and they need to start working on it. So I gotta do some stuff, but they know we're available to them. They have a problem or they want, you know, I did this recording for this service band audition, would you listen to the recording? Of course we're there. You know, it's like, well, you have to ask? Of course, send it out. We'll listen to it. We'll talk about it, you know, and booking extra Zooms and trying to, especially during pandemic, keep community together because community is really important.
Yeah, that was one of the last things I want to talk to you about was with the pandemic. Obviously, this sucks, and hopefully we'll be out of it in a couple months or sometime.
Yeah, well, sometime.
Whatever, we'll see. But how has this affected your students and sort of the their view on the world in music and are they optimistic? I mean, how do you guys hold that together?
Well, I consistently talk about the gift of pandemic because it's given us extra time, and that time could be used well. It can be squandered. It can be, but it also has given us time to think about who we are and what we're doing and why we're doing it.
Right.
So everybody should take out pencil and paper right now and write down a book title called The Practice by Seth Godin, G-O-D-I-N. Fascinating book. And I was going to say the gist of it, but there's a lot going on in that book. I wouldn't want to oversimplify it. But part of what it's talking about is the need to create without thinking about what's on the other side. You're not creating to be popular. You're not creating for a job. You're not creating for this or that. You're creating because what we do is the act of practicing this, mm-hmm. practicing what we do. And it's not just like practicing Clark studies, but practicing our voice, practicing our this act of creation that is music. And he's not a musician. He's like a business guy. He's an MBA guy. And he's got, I think, a million followers to his blog. This is like not... It is specific to art, I think, this book, sort of.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of his other books are about strictly about business. And he does bash capitalism a little in this book and the industrial complex and stuff, you know. So he's got his things. But the people who I think who have been most successful are the ones that have been able to get into this groove of the need to create. Without the worry of when's the next audition, because I can't tell you. Nobody can.
Right.
A friend of mine got bashed on the web for saying, well, this isn't going to be turned. We're not going to be turned around and having auditions in 3 months. And it's my friend's right, unfortunately. Sorry.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of orchestras are going to be coming out of hiring freezes. I mean, we have an opening in Philly. Bob Early retired. And so we have an opening. When is that going to audition? I can't tell you. I know it's not going to be this year. It probably isn't going to be next season. It might be the season after. It could be the season after that.
Right. Yeah.
I guarantee you it will get auditioned.
Yeah.
You know? Probably some openings, a bunch of other openings. I'm not going to mention the orchestras and or opera companies. But there's or ballet companies, there's going to be openings, and they're going to happen. And the folks who are creating now and working on their craft are going to be in the right position to take advantage of those.
Right.
Now, I joke about the gift of pandemic. You know, it's an awful thing. That's just saying that's an encouragement to make the most of this time and to realize that the way we view time right now has been different. For me, it was a gift because with a newborn in the house, I've just realized that I've missed 65 days on the road that I would have not been a part of her life over the last 12 months. So I've been here every day. My commute is down a flight of stairs. That's cool, right? But it's the flip side is the damage that this has done, not only to people who have gotten the virus and passed. And, you know, I'm not making light of those sacrifices at all and those tragedies. But a parallel tragedy to that has been folks who have not been able to look beyond today. And like my senior recital was virtual, or I'm not doing this, or I'm graduating and I haven't played in an ensemble, or I'm a senior in high school and I didn't even get to go and do campus tours and I'm having to guess where to go to college. It's like, well, you know what? Trust. You're going to be fine.
Yeah.
Do what you do. But it's been hard for people and it's been a stress and it's caused, you know, when we're under stress, it's a hard thing. And it's hard to get in that groove and find yourself when you're not in a mindset that is in a good way. And most of us have a choice of how we're going to view each day when we wake up in the morning. Sadly, some of us don't have that. You know, there are some people who can't, you know, they're wired in a way that, you know, without appropriate help, they can't find that. But I think the majority of us have that choice in the day. And my old tennis teacher used to say, it's a new day, it's a new opportunity to excel. And then it just became, it's a new day, new op. He would say that every day, every time, you know, my kids went to his tennis camp, and it's like new day, new op. And there's a beauty in accepting that.
Right.
It's not saying don't go out and fight. It's not saying don't change the world. It's saying you have the opportunity to do all that stuff.
Yeah.
Make the most of it. And it goes back to Gandalf. We have to make the most of the time we're given.
Absolutely.
And it seems like here we are, you know, stuck in our homes in pandemic. But we can still make a lot. And you look at what a lot of people have been doing. People have been finding ways to flourish in their art, even without regular concerts. And it's going to change the art form. It already has. And it will continue to do so in the orchestra business and in the arts in general.
Yeah, absolutely.
And it's a positive. It's a positive.
Yeah.
I think.
Well, I think
change is good.
Yeah.
My daughter, I have a daughter who's 30, 31 now, and don't tell. But she, at her med school graduation, the speaker said this memorable quote, and he said, "For those of you who are resistant to change, I guarantee you'll like irrelevance even less."
Ooh.
And obviously that has stuck with me.
Yeah. Wow.
Evolution. Change. It's positive. It's direction. And that's what we all need to be doing right now, is figuring out what direction we're moving in.
Right.
And I think we can do that in a really wonderful way.
Yeah.
You know?
It's been great to see musicians kind of take over the face of their orchestras during this time. You know,
they were personalized.
Yeah, very personalized.
I have a viola colleague, and I know what her cats look like now because they were in one of her videos that we put up on social. I know things about colleagues. We have a cellist who plays the harmonica. I mean, you know, it's like, cool, dude, you know?
Yeah.
But the stuff people have been, the personalization has been really, really wonderful. And I think audience building comes from that. And maybe the orchestras will start to understand, as amazing as Yo-Yo is, that there are other stories we can tell than having just a big star up front. That there's
yeah.
personalization. It's
the audience,
humans.
For access, right?
It's cool. And I think we may finally not be playing in tails anymore. Not that that's going to solve our problems, because I always used to laugh reading countless articles. What's so off-putting about classical music is the tails. But heck, I'd rather wear the black suit, dude. I mean, you know, then you can go to the bar after work, right? you don't have to change out of that zoot suit, right?
Change.
It's so hard to keep that white stuff clean, too. Valve oil and
The valve oil, yeah. People don't understand how really messed up our shirts get with the valve oil.
Yeah, no, it's a terrible thing.
The last question I wanted to ask you about was something you were talking about just a minute ago. Can you talk about Baset a little bit? I mean, how all that came about and the connection you guys had from Afghanistan? I mean, that's an amazing story. I mean, I know a lot of people who are watching this have seen it, but for those who haven't, it's a great story. And it was on CBS, which was really cool and kind of a tear-jerking moment there.
It was actually, you know, that was special. And Steve Hartman spent a day at my house. I mean, it was so cool because he's just like, he and his cameraman, they're like two of the funniest humans I've ever met. But wow. He is as real as he seems on TV. And we keep in touch, which is very strange.
You and Steve Hartman to keep in touch?
Yeah, we trade emails every once in a while. We were just in touch. Well, when he was doing the TAPS thing, he reached out. And they asked me to do a thing as a part of that.
That's right.
It's like, you know, and he came to Saratoga to hear the orchestra, and I showed his family around. We arranged a tour a couple of years ago for him to see backstage and stuff. I mean, really, really just, again, you see somebody, it's like, oh, he's a TV guy, and he does these tear-jerking stories, but he's actually real. I mean, his personality, he's just a really, really warm, warm human. But back to Baset, I got this Facebook message, and literally it said, "My name's Baset. I live in Afghanistan, and I'm the best trumpet player in Afghanistan because there are only two." And I just had to laugh, right? It's like, are you kidding me? Really? That is so cool. And then, you know, he said, can you help me? So Mark, what happens when somebody says to you, can you help me? How do you answer them?
You hope you can. You hope
you're, say yes, right?
Say yes, of course.
Especially if they're funny and they, they have such a good opening line, right?
That opening line, you cannot ignore that, right?
And so then it's like, well, what do you need? And he's like, well, here in Kabul, he was going to the National School of Music there, National Institute of Music, and they didn't have a trumpet teacher anymore because the other one left, and it started to get dangerous, a lot more dangerous with the Taliban, and they couldn't find somebody to come in and teach the trumpet. So he's like, yeah, I'm studying music and studying English, but I don't have a trumpet teacher. Can you teach me? And at that point, it was like, you know, Zoom wasn't Zoom, right? There wasn't really this. Oh, my goodness.
Who's coming in?
Is that Baset?
It is.
Hi.
Hey, dude.
So I've been enjoying the conversation today, so thank you for that.
Wow. Man, look at that beard. You look so cool.
I'm getting older, you know?
I know. You're all grown up these days. But you know, it was like, well, sure, we started working together, and then he told me his dream of coming to the U.S. to go to Interlochen. And I thought, well, let's get in first. So we worked on his video, and he's a practicer. He works hard, this guy, right? And he made this beautiful video and sent it in, and they're like, yeah, okay. And they offered him, you know, half scholarship. And I don't know if you know about Interlochen, but it's not cheap. So at that point, it's like, oh, my gosh, we've got to raise some money, because how can we say no? This is like, it's the most beautiful, beautiful story ever, right?
Yeah.
And there's a woman in Dallas who I knew a little bit when I was down there, named Robin Korovar. And Robin, amazing, amazing woman. She and I started on this journey to try to raise the funds. And we had a lot of generous people, a lot of generous people, you know, ranging from $5 to Yannick at $5,000. And we raised, you know, enough, you know, about $35,000 for Baset to go to Interlochen. And then I remember I was in Colorado, and it was in July, and Baset was coming in August, and we did a call, you know, FaceTime, and with his parents. And I was in, kids were asleep. Well, Andreas was sleeping, and we were in this tiny condo. And so I went into the lobby of the hotel, which had better Wi-Fi anyway. And, you know, people were looking at me because they're hearing, you know, a language they don't know. And they're seeing people, and they're looking at me a little funny, right? Like, what are you doing? And Baset's dad came on. First, his mom came on, and she was crying, but that was okay. And then his dad came on and was like, you know, not only thank you, look after my son, but can you help him come to college here? And, you know, that stuck. And then Baset got to Interlochen, and, you know, he's like making great grades. And I'm thinking, you know, here's a guy whose English is his second language, and he's doing school in English and getting all like really great grades. And it's like, okay, let's do this college thing up. And so, you know, we went through that whole process, and then it was, you know, he was making decisions where to go, and got some good scholarship, but we needed to raise more. And once again, these amazing people came through, and you know, it was 85, 90,000. I don't know. We raised enough for 4 years of school.
It's amazing. It's amazing.
So it's a story of Baset's perseverance, his amazing personality, his and people hearing, can you help, and saying yes. Right? And you know, as long as I live, I will never forget how many. We had over, I think, the total number of like over 1,000, maybe 1,100 people who donated.
Yeah.
1,100 people who are saying, here's somebody I don't know. Here, let me help you. Doesn't that sort of make you go like, yeah, maybe humankind isn't doomed after all.
Maybe it's not a right? bad thing.
And well, here's a young man, I should let him speak, who's made the absolute most out of this experience.
Yeah. Baset, do you have anything to say for yourself?
No, but I you know, I still remember the day I met Mr. Bilger. It was exciting. The CBS crew was there, of course. I didn't actually know that they were recording when we first meet, because I thought, well, we're just going to meet in person. Then they will do an interview or whatever. But that was an exciting moment for me to see someone that I connected so well with him, just through Skype, Facebook, on social media. And then seeing you in person walking, and you're like, oh, this is a real person. And that
was
fun.
We knew each other pretty well by that point, but it was, you know, we're both like crying and stuff. Okay, yeah. Right, you know.
Yeah. Although, I mean, as you mentioned, we did talk every week, but seeing someone that you admire and you respect in person, and you see this actual real human being, and he can walk and you can hug, and that was a special. So something
I wasn't walking so good then. I needed to have hip surgery, but I hobbled over and gave you a hug. But, yeah, but then also like trying to learn to cook Afghan food when Baset was visiting and staying here, it was like, and he's looking at me like, you were sure that was going to taste awful, didn't you? You were looking at me like, what are you doing in that kitchen?
No, actually, you're a good cook. And I.
But he, like, how much of that? He went like nuts on it. I guess it was good. But, yeah. You know, but just, you know, for Andreas, my son, to get to meet and know Baset and to know how we can connect with people. And how we can learn to care about people that are from, what is it, 7,000 miles away?
Yeah, what was
that? Is that where you grew up? How many miles away is that?
It is long away.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, it's a small world and a really special one, you know?
Yeah. What was the lesson when you guys were doing lessons? I mean, what, 7,000 miles? That's a pretty big time shift.
8.5 or 9.5 hours, right? Depending on.
So what time of day were lessons in the United States versus Kabul? Were you at 4 a.m. or something? I mean, what was that like?
Well, I mean, we were like, okay, how early can you get to, because they had to happen at the school because the internet was good at the school. Mm-hmm. And so it was like, how early can you get there? So it was basically, I don't know, you were 6:30 in the morning, something
I
like that?
I think so.
Yeah, and it was either 9 or 10 at night in Philly.
Wow.
So it was early. And then one time I was like, Baset, have you warmed up today? And he goes, no, I hadn't. And I was like, why? He goes, it's raining. And I'm like, raining? And he says, I'll send you pictures. Right? And so then, you know, we had the lesson and he sent pictures of what he had gone through to get to the school. And it was like a river down the streets, right? He was trudging through muddy water, like knee deep to get there for this lesson. And you know, that sacrifice, that's like, how much do you want it? How much does this mean?
Yeah. Well, and what is the impact too? I mean, some the students, I mean, so now you're going to University of Kansas, so Steve Leisering's your teacher there. And the kids you met at Interlochen, I mean, what the impact that you must have had on those students for their worldview, which has just been very singular, very United States. And the stuff you had to come through, what, you know, how has that changed people? I think that's what one of the biggest gifts has to be is the influence you have on your colleagues or people that just know you on social media, because I see your posts on Facebook and sometimes it's incredibly optimistic and sometimes it's brutally honest about things that happen in Afghanistan. Yeah. It's a very different perspective than I think most people have.
Sure. No, I have been very blessed. As Mr. Bilger said, there are so many people that they supported. And I think, you know, in terms of, you know, you saying as someone that you have probably touched the most, I received an email after the CBS from a, I think she was a sixth grade or seventh grade from Texas. She was a clarinet player, and she said all wonderful things. And at the end, she said, I really do not like to practice my scales, but after watching this story, I promise to practice 5 minutes every day. And that was the coolest thing I ever read, and I read that email a couple of times. And so, you know, seeing those people that they can see value in your work and yourself, I think that's important. And I'm sure, you know, I learned from so many people, and I appreciate to be around human beings. And as Mr. Bilger said, there's so many people, you know, we can always learn from. It is sad that there's some negative things happening in the world, but they are still kind people around us.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's so easy to lose sight of that, you know, because there's so much that could be better.
Yeah.
But, you know, one life at a time, one person at a time. You know?
Well, you guys have both had a tremendous impact on so many people. And that, I mean, that story was, I'm not crying, you're crying, kind of a moment when you saw him. Yes.
Well, that's Steve Hartman. I mean, he asked me, he said, so nobody's that altruistic. Why did you do this? Why'd you help him? And because he asked, I don't know. It just seemed like the right thing to do. I don't know.
Yeah.
I didn't have a good answer for him, and maybe I still don't.
Well, I think,
it's. I think a lot of folks, if they were presented with the opportunity to make a difference, that big a difference in somebody's life, I hope people would do it if they could, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
What shocked me was that we were successful in making it all happen. Not, I never doubted Bassett's abilities or his ability to get into Interlaken, but everything from getting the visa. I mean, that was a whole nother thing where he got a yellow, not, you know, it was like, didn't get the green, didn't get the, like, in the first time. And we're like, oh my gosh, do we just go through all of this and then the U.S. government's not going to let him in? And then finally it worked out. But like, they're just, you know, first of all, it was like just getting the paperwork done. Then it was getting a visa, raising money, you know, and just everything. We just, you know, at some point you just have faith that things are going to work.
Yeah.
And if they hadn't, we would have found some other way to do something, right? I mean, you know, there's always ways to try. And that's that book, the Seth Godin book, is about, you know, you do what you do, not because you believe that the outcome will happen, but because you believe in the process. You believe in what you're doing. And that's what we did.
Well,
I'm so much richer having gotten to know Baset and having him as a friend. I mean, you know, the pandemic's awful because we were supposed to play together last summer. We were going to play at Arlington Cemetery for the U.S. military, you know, and that got, it all got canceled, but we will do it again, you know?
Yeah. Well, you're paying it forward. I mean, you talked about this at the beginning of this interview, that, you know, the people that gave you recordings to listen to as a kid, or the way that,
well, sure,
maybe the extra time, and then you pay it forward, and Bassett will pay it forward too. I mean, he's already doing that in his own way right now, so. But,
well, I mean, we're looking at a young man who's going to change the world one way or another. We don't know. I don't know how, but I know you're going to, you know, and that's not putting pressure on you. It's just you being you. It's just you. There's something magical there, my friend.
Thank you. I appreciate it. No, you know, you meet so many people, and especially sometimes I think about musicians. There's so many wonderful musicians. But there, you know, you cannot connect with everyone. And for me, I connect with those that I respect their personality, and someone that I want to not just learn music or whatever I'm learning, but also say, this is a great example, I can live like them. And so I appreciate that, and I appreciate, you know, having you as someone that I can look up to, someone that I can trust and talk to, and someone that I can hope to be like yourself, not as a trumpet player, but as a human being, hopefully.
Well, and then you got to come to Philly and you got to meet baby Rose, because she's really cute.
For sure.
Before she's grown up.
Yeah.
Oh. Well, guys, I can't thank you both enough. Just hang on a second, because I'll sign us off here. But Dave, you've been so generous with your time tonight. And it's like the messages, there's so many messages on the Facebook. I can't even keep track of people saying hello. And Chris Bubos and Phil Sinatico, Royce Davis and Gail Williams, and I think Mick McKay was watching a little bit ago. So many people, and I'm very grateful. And Baset, thank you for coming in and the conversation. Watching is a lot of nasty stuff out there, and it's really nice to watch two people be kind to each other and pay things forward like this.
So well, let's all change the world, at least in our own little corners of it, you know?
Yeah.
This is a bigger story because it's so far apart. But we can change things right where we live, you know?
Exactly. Well, gentlemen, thank you so much. And thanks everybody that watched tonight. And we'll see you sometime soon.